Landmarks in the development of plant virology. Now we will see what are all the contribution that happens in the timeline for development of plant virology. Now we will see one by one. And my name is Janesh Shankar Reddy, and I am doing a PhD plant pathology in Annamalai University. So starts with a very old one in the 16th century. It is called a tulipomania. It is a viral disease. The only viral disease which is benefited in a tulip production. So most of the viral diseases are harmful as well as it reduces production as well as the productivity. This disease which actually increases the production as well as the value of tulips. That is called a tulipomania. Actually, tulips which are introduced from Netherlands in those days of 16th century, which has the color variations or broken color variations on the left side. We can see here the color of the red color tulip likely changes into white color, or color variations can be seen here. Due to that color variation, the demand and market price of the tulip can be increased unimaginably. So the price of the tulip can be increased unimaginably due to this disease. So later days, nowadays, because of advanced technologies and advanced detection techniques, now we discovered that it was caused by group of Poteivirus. So it is caused due to Poteivirus, and these are transmitted by aphids. So we can see here variation of tulip color, tulip flowers look like a very beautiful and fetches more market price than usual. These were the diagrams which was drawn by different scientists as well as novel writers and authors. We can see here color breaking, tulip color breaking. This was caused by Poteivirus. This is one of the benefited viral diseases due to beautiful color variations and color changes. Adolf Meyer, he is a German scientist who coined the term mosaic. So mosaic is the most common symptom that is produced by the plant pathogenic virus. So after the infection of the plant virus, almost all plant pathogenic virus produce mosaic symptom, that is yellowing symptom. That is the initial symptom that is produced by the almost all plant pathogenic virus. It is one of the most important symptoms. So the term mosaic was coined by Adolf Meyer, and he first proved that the transmission nature of plant virus, that is TMV. He is the man first told that tobacco mosaic virus or mosaic disease of tobacco can be transmitted by sap, by means of sap. So he called that sap transmission of tobacco is called mosaic concrete. Mosaic concrete. It is in German language, mosaic concrete. The sap transmission of tobacco disease, he called it as a mosaic concrete. He performed the Chamberlain filter paper experiment. Even after passing to the Chamberlain filter paper experiment, the virus retains infectivity. And what he thought that? He thought that the disease of mosaic or a mosaic disease of tobacco, which is caused by bacteria, because you don't know that whether it is caused by virus or something else. So actually he thought that the mosaic disease of tobacco was caused by bacteria in those times. So there is a chance in national eligibility exams, they will ask like this: who coined the term mosaic, and mosaic concrete was coined by, or who thought that the mosaic disease of tobacco was caused by bacteria? So the answer for all these questions is Adolf Meyer. The term mosaic was coined by Adolf Meyer, and he is the man who thought that the mosaic disease of tobacco is caused by bacteria. That is Adolf Meyer. In the right side, we can see the diagrammatic diagram of Adolf Meyer. Picture of Adolf Meyer. Is a German scientist. And the next one is Dmitry Ivanovsky. Is a Russian scientist. He proved that the causal agent of tobacco could pass through the bacterial proof filter, which means if the sap can transmitted through bacterial proof filter, even though after passing to the bacterial filters, it retains the infectivity. So which means after passing to the bacterial filter, if it is really a bacteria, it can't retain the infectivity. But after passing to the bacterial filter, that was the experiment which is performed by the Ivanovsky, even though after passing the bacterial filters, it retains its infectivity, which he concluded that the causal organism of mosaic disease of tobacco, which is smaller than that of bacteria, because after retaining the infectivity. So he concluded that the mosaic disease of tobacco is not caused by bacteria. bacteria, not caused by bacteria. And is the man first discovered the inclusion bodies? Inclusion bodies are the identification or diagnostic symptoms for the presence of a virus in the plant cells. In the presence of virus in the plant cells, he described the horizontal transmission of plant viruses. In national eligibility test, they will ask like, you know, who coined the term or who discovered the inclusion bodies? Who discovered the inclusion bodies? And they will told and they will ask questions like this. And who told that the mosaic disease of tobacco was not caused by bacteria? That is Ivanovsky, is a Russian scientist. On the right side, we can see Ivanovsky, and he really laid a great foundation for the starting of plant virology. And our next one is Bijernik or Bijerink. So he is a Dutch microbiologist as well as a botanist. He is considered as founder and father of plant virology. He is also considered as father of environmental ecology. He coined the term virus. Actually, virus is a Latin word which means venom or poison or slimy liquid. So he called that the liquid material of the virus, that is the sap, or the liquid material of a virus, is called contagium vivum fluidum, which means a contagious material which has a capability to transmit their nature to the uninfected ones So the first known sulfate reducing bacteria, that is Spirillum disulficans. Now it is called as Disulfovibrio disulficans. So Clostridium bijernik is a gram positive rod shaped motile bacteria which was named after Bijernik. So by honoring Bijernik, the Clostridium bijernik is a gram positive bacteria which was named after Bijernik. So occasionally, so many times the Bijernik told that Ivanovsky contributions are really helped me to develop or to contribute more to the plant virology. So he is considered as founder of plant virology. Is also considered as father of environmental ecology. He introduced the term virus, which is a Latin word which means venom, poison or slimy liquid, and he called the liquid material as contagium vivum fluidum. And the next one is Twaut and Herrelli. So Twaut and Herrelli individually discovered bacteriophages. Twaut in the year of 1915, whereas F.D. Herrelli in the year of 1917, they are individually discovered bacteriophages. Because nowadays we have the lots of technology is developed. We have 4G and 5G nets. You know, we have a globally developed, well-developed worldwide web system and the internets. Everything we have. On those time, we don't have that type of. They don't have that type of system. That's why they had. They are individually discovered. Twaut was discovered in the year of 1915, whereas F.D. Herrelli was discovered in the year of 1917 in different locations. But they don't know whether that was discovered before or some other scientists whether it was discovered before or not, because of technological development. That's why the contribution will devoted to both of them, that is Twaut and Herrelli. They're individually discovered bacteriophages. Here the meaning of bacteriophages are bacterial eaters. Bacteriophages means bacterial eaters. So coming to the definition of bacteriophages, the phages are the bacterial eaters, which means virus which infect bacteria. Is called bacteriophages. So the term bacteriophage was coined by Herrelli. On the lower side, he is a Twaut. And he is F.D. Herrelli. He called bacteriophages, or he introduced the term bacteriophages. Even though they discovered individually, but Twaut never introduced the term bacteriophages, whereas F.D. Herrelli introduced the term bacteriophages and named it as a bacteriophages, which means bacterial eaters, or the virus which infect bacteria is called bacteriophages. The next one is Holmes. Holmes is a scientist who developed a tool or a procedure for local lesion assay, a procedure that is called a local lesion assay in Nicotiana glutinosa. Now we'll see what is the definition of a local lesion assay, which is a tool that is developed for the measuring of plant viruses, which shows that the amount of virus which is present in the plant sap which is proportional to the number of lesions developed on the host leaves, that is rubbed with sap. Very simple. So let us consider if the large amount of sap which is there in the infected plant, if you rub with rub on an uninfected plant, how much concentration that it has in the infected plants, the same amount of concentration or lesions that is developed on the uninfected plants. That's they are telling. The amount of sap which is present in the infected plant is directly proportional to the amount of lesions that is developed or rubbed with the sap of the uninfected plants. So, and they observed the single dominant gene for the controlling of hypersensitivity, that is called viral hypersensitivity. Viral hypersensitivity, which means a single dominant gene that controls the hypersensitivity. So, hypersensitivity reaction means autolysis or cell death to prevent the spread of the infection. Let us consider if the infection occurs in a leaf of a particular area, the plants, what the plants will do to prevent the spread of the disease to the uninfected cells or the further cells, the cells which are present in the infected area, they will die themselves. That is called autolysis or the hypersensitivity. So here the hypersensitivity in virus was discovered by Holmes, whereas fungal hypersensitivity was discovered by Stockman, whereas the bacterial hypersensitivity was discovered by Staskovics, whereas the viral hypersensitivity was discovered by Holmes. So this type of questions that they will place in the national eligibility tests are, you know, different types of entrance exams. So hypersensitivity in virus was discovered by Holmes, and moreover the Holmes developed their single dominant, subsequently transferred to the Nicotiana glutinosa to Nicotiana tabacum, that is tobacco plants, in which tobacco mosaic resistant cultivars are produced. Very, very important. So the genes, the single dominant genes which are present in the Nicotiana glutinosa, it is a type species of tobacco, which is transferred into the commercially cultivated tobacco, that is Nicotiana tobacco, due to the transfer of these genes that enhance the capability of resistance capability against the tobacco mosaic virus in tobacco plants, is the Holmes. In the right side we can see is the FC Holmes. And the next one is McKinney. McKinney developed the cross protection technique or pre-immunization techniques for the control of Citrus tristeza virus. Even though the cross protection technique was first used against or actually developed for tobacco mosaic virus, but now this technique was widely or extensively used for the control of Citrus tristeza virus. Citrus tristeza virus. So cross protection technique was developed by McKinney for the control of Citrus tristeza virus. Even though the technique actually developed for tobacco mosaic virus, but now extensively used for Citrus tristeza virus. So what is cross protection? Coming to the definition of cross protection, the use of mild strains of virus to prevent or to reduce the infection of severe strains of viruses. Now next one is 1931 to 30, that is Noel and Ruska. They developed the first type of electron microscope, first prototype of electron microscope, which was developed by Ernest Ruska and Noel. Initially they was developed for the capability of 400 magnification power. Initially they developed 400 magnification power. In the later days, in 1933, Ruska, they developed the first complete resolution electron microscope that works on the optical lights. So which has a then 1933 they developed the next developed prototype of electron microscope, which has a capability to magnify almost 1 lakh to 10 lakhs times bigger than that of original image. So with the development of electron microscope, the speed of the virology can be hugely increased. We can see the virus and we can understand the machinery of a virus, how it infect and what what is the nature and what is the shapes and their physical properties, as well as we can understand all those things. That definitely is the greatest contribution for the development of electron microscope. So due to the development of electron microscope, Ruska won Nobel Prize in the year of 1986. Ruska won Nobel Prize in the 1986 for his fundamental work on optics, as well as the development of first electron microscope. On the right side, we can see this is the first developed prototype of electron microscope, which has a 400 magnification power. These two are the scientists who, Noel and Ruska. K.M. Smith. he first introduced the use of indicator plant in viral studies. So different types of indicator plants can be used in our viral studies so that we can easily identify the infection of the particular virus. So normally goose foot, that is Chinopodium amaranthicolor, is used for the identification of viral diseases. So K.M. Smith were first thought that use of indicator plant in plant viral studies, and he separated that potato virus disease and named it as a potato virus X and potato virus Y. Potato virus X and potato virus Y. And he authored a textbook that is called Plant Virus Diseases, which was published in the year of 1937. And he named and grouped the viruses according to the generic name of the host. So the use of indicator plant in viral studies was first thought by K.M. Smith. The next one is Martin Schlesinger. Martin Schlesinger is an Hungarian scientist, and he is the man who first separated and purified bacteriophages by a technique called ultracentrifugation. By using this ultracentrifugation technique, he separated and purified the bacteriophages. And the Martin Schlesinger concluded that the bacteriophages contains equal amounts of proteins and as well as DNA. So Martin Schlesinger he used a technique called ultracentrifugation for the separation and purification of bacteriophages, and he concluded that the bacteriophages contains equal amount of proteins as well as DNA. The next one is W.M. Stanley, who is an American biologist as well as a virologist. He purified and crystallized virus for the first time. So he purified and crystallized the virus for the first time. It is a very, 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 very important question. And I had seen this question in many places, many pathology exams, many exams. Definitely this question will be there everywhere. So purification or crystallization of a virus can be done by Stanley. So he used a chemical called ammonium sulfate. By using the ammonium sulfate, he purified or crystallized the plant viruses, which means, you know, purification or crystallization means the preparation of enzymes or virus proteins in a pure form. That is purification or crystallization. For the crystallization of tobacco mosaic virus for the first time, he received a Nobel Prize in the year of 1946. For the crystallization of tobacco mosaic virus. And he believed that the virus is an autocatalytic protein that can multiply within the living cells. The thing autocatalytic protein, which means autocatalytic proteins which have the capability of both the living and non-living nature, which means if the living host is available, the virus can activate and it can acts like a living cell. If the host is not available, or you know, the obligate host is not living host is not available, what will happen? It can be like as usual and like a dead cells. That is called autocatalytic protein, which means having the capabilities of both living and non-living nature. And due to his work of purification as a crystallization, molecular plant pathology work can be initiated. So molecular plant pathology work can be initiated with the work of W.M. Stanley, that is purification or crystallization. So that the type of questions that may put in national eligibility test is, you know, who purified or crystallized virus, that is a W.M. Stanley. So what is the chemical that is used in the purification of plant virus, that is TMV? So ammonium sulfate. So for this purification, he received Nobel Prize in the year of 1946. On the right side, we can see W.M. Stanley. He is a W.M. Stanley. The next one is F.C. Bowden and N.W. Pyle. As I strongly believe, these are the definitely great contributors to the development of plant virology. So unfortunately, they didn't receive any Nobel Prize, even though definitely I strongly believe that their contributions are really great to the development of plant virology. They demonstrated that the virus contains nucleoprotein. The virus is a nucleoprotein, which means which consists of nucleic acid as well as protein. That's they call it as a nucleoprotein. So F.C. Bowden and N.W. Pyle demonstrated that virus is a nucleoprotein which consists of nucleic acid as well as protein. And they also purified and crystallized the TMV in the year of 1936, and they concluded that the Stanley experiment is right. So, and they further purified the proteins in a neutral aqueous solution and can obtain in a liquid crystalline states, liquid crystalline states, they first suggested this virus replication might be to the analog to the synthesis of a cellular components. Virus replication might be analog to the synthesis of cellular components in the sense how much the cells are replicated, which means how much the living cells inside a plant living system are replicated, that the same analog of viral replication will also occur, because once the plant virus enter into the plant cells, the more number of replications, if the more number of replications will happen, the more number of viral components can be developed, that they are telling, that they are telling, which means replication might be analog to the synthesis of cellular components. So, and they detect that the phosphate is inherent part of RNA molecule. So phosphate is one of the important molecule, component in RNA molecule, that they are demonstrated. And the type of questions that they will ask in a national eligibility test is who called that virus is a nucleoprotein, which means nucleic acid and combination of protein, that is NC Bowden and NW Pyrie. He is FC Bowden and he is NW Pyrie's colleague. And then Luria and Delbrück. So they discovered Luria and Delbrück, combined, they discovered bacterial mutations. And they are considered as founding father of phage genetics. And they received Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in the year of 1966. And they also worked on the replication mechanism of genetic structure of viruses. So Delbrück alone discovered the mutation in virus in the year of 1939. So here, Luria and Delbrück combined, they discovered bacterial mutations, whereas Delbrück alone discovered the mutations in plant viruses. So he is Luria and he is Delbrück. Next contribution is Watson and Crick. So they discovered the double helical structure of DNA, in which their discovery revolutionized the entire biology. So after discovering the structure of DNA, that is deoxyribonucleic acid, the man starts to play with God, because we can alter the genome and we can produce whatever we want. As I strongly believe, in future, maybe in 50 days or 100 days, we can develop our own clones. Definitely we can develop our own clones. Nowadays it was not legal. Definitely it's future. I strongly believe that is possible. We can develop clones of plant viruses, clones of humans, that can be very efficient against the different types of viral diseases, not only human viral diseases but also plant viral diseases. So here on the right side, we can see this is the structure and model of double helical structure of DNA, which consists of two bonds combining. We can see here, for their discovery, or the greatest discovery, they received the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in the year of 1962. These are Watson and Crick. You can see the double helical structure of DNA, which means a double helix consists of two helix, which are combined or bonded in between A, T, G, C. I hope all will know about this. Adenine, guanine, thymine, cytosine, these are the nucleoside bases, which are linked one by one. So this DNA mostly consists of phosphorus as well as phosphorus molecules or iron molecules, which are strongly present in it. So the next one is Hershey and Chase experiment. So they demonstrated that infection behavior of bacteriophages showed that the only DNA enters into the host cell and the proteins which are remains present outside. So what is Hershey and Chase experiment, that I will explain you here. Hershey and Chase experiment, that I will tell you. Let us consider it is a plant cell. So the bacteriophage will be like this hexagonal structure. So this is bacteriophage. So it consists of tail fibers which is come in contact with the, so this is genome which is present inside a bacteriophage. What will happen after attaching to the plant cell here? The genome alone only enters into the plant cell. That can destruct the plant genome which is present inside here. What will happen? This is protein code which is present outside only. What will happen here? The genome which is present inside the bacteriophage alone enters into the plant cell or any living cell. That is the experiment they explained what actually. So they showed that DNA alone enters into the host cell, protein remains outside. That this is the experiment that I told you. So Here, the nucleic acid portion is the responsible for the infectivity and carried the genetic material, because the entire genetic information which was present inside the nucleic acid only. Protein coat only protect the nucleic acid. So that is their experiment, Hershey and Chase experiment, which means nucleic acid alone is the infectious material, whereas protein coat remains outside while the bacteriophage infecting the cells. The next was is Geirer and Schramm. They showed that nucleic acid, they concluded or completely showed that nucleic acid is the infectious material of plant virus. It is a very, 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 very important contribution. So I had seen this question many, many places, because it's a very, very important. Who told that the nucleic acid is the infectious material of plant virus? That is Geirer and Schramm. They showed that only nucleic acid of TMV, not only TMV, only the nucleic acid of the plant virus is the infectious portion or infectious portion or a part of plant viruses. So, and also investigated about the double-stranded RNA viruses, double-stranded RNA viruses. These are the Geirer, Schramm, and Henze, Frankel, Krantek, the scientists. Hewitt, they first reported that grape fan leaf virus is transmitted by a nematode, that is Ziphenema index. It is a nematode which transmits the plant viral disease, that is grape fan leaf virus. It's a very, very important. Grape fan leaf virus is transmitted by, they will ask like this, grape fan leaf virus is transmitted by Ziphenema index, which is a nematode, which was first reported by Hewitt in the year of 1958. The next one is Tickle. So they first reported the transmission of plant viruses by means of fungi. That is Wolfidium brassicae, which is a soil-borne fungi, which is responsible for the transmission of tobacco necrosis virus. Tobacco necrosis virus, which is transmitted by a fungi, Wolfidium brassicae. The next one is Shifford. In 1968, he first reported that the DNA viruses. Before that, all discovered viruses are contains RNA as a genetic material. Then this discovery, that Shifford discovery, then astonished the plant virologists. Oh, the plant viruses also contains DNA as a genetic material. That too, double-stranded DNA as a genetic material. So that is cauliflower mosaic virus, where they first investigated. So it's a very, very important question. Cauliflower mosaic virus contains a genome as double-stranded DNA. So the next contribution is Takabe and Oshoki. So they described the technique for the propagation of propagating and infectious protoplasts with viruses, and they they allowed the many detailed studies for the virus replication eventually due to the regression of plant viruses and protoplasts and all those things will be played. Then Kohler and Milstein. It's a very, 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 very important, but it's a very long process to develop hybridoma monoclonal antibodies. That is Kohler and Milstein first developed hybridoma technology. Hybridoma is a breakthrough technology which is used for the production of monoclonal antibodies. So due to this monoclonal antibodies, we can develop the cancer resistant cells, we can develop everything in our human body, whatever we want, we can develop something new. So this technology was developed by Kohler and Milstein. For their greatest discovery, they received Nobel Prize in the year of 1984 for their discovery. He is a Kohler and he is a Milstein. Then Wohler 1976, as well as Clark and Adams in 1977, they developed a technique called ELISA, which is used for the detection of plant viruses. ELISA in the sense, enzyme linked immunosorbent assay is a technique which is developed by Clark and Adams as well as Wohler, which is used for the detection of plant virus. It is the most sensitive technique which can detect plant viruses. The sensitivity ranges from 1 to 10 nanogram per ml. It is the most sensitive technique which is used for the discovery or which is used for the detection of plant viruses. The next one is Klug. So he developed the crystallographic electron microscopy for the structural elucidation of biological impact of nucleic acid protein complexes. It's the first discovered crystallographic electron microscopy. So due to this crystallographic electron microscopy, what will happen, the biologically important nucleic acid proteins can be elucidated and we can understand. And then Powell and Beechey, and they initiated the molecular plant pathology their work for their work. So actually what they developed the resistance genes, or improving or developing the resistant genes against plant viruses. So the first developed the transgenic resistance mediated coat protein, transgenic mediated resistant coat protein for the in tobacco mosaic, against tobacco mosaic virus. The first time they developed a coat protein resistance genes against tobacco mosaic virus. BC alone developed the coat protein mediated gene resistance, which means by obtaining the coat protein, if we inactivated coat protein in the plant viruses, we can easily control the plant viruses rather than spraying insecticides and all those things. This will be the better idea of controlling plant viruses rather than going of chemicals and all those things. So BC developed the coat protein mediated gene resistance against tobacco mosaic virus in. And then Stanley Prusiner, who discovered the prions in animals. Prions in the sense, here in the prions in the cells. Prions are the infectious proteins. Prions are the infectious proteins which has a capability to transmit their infectious nature to what normally protein, normally functional proteins. It is an infectious protein which it has a capability to transmit their infectious nature to normal protein which don't have any infectivity. That is called prions. Prions means malfunctioned protein which is present in the brains. So for the discovery of prion diseases in animals as well as human beings, he discovered a Nobel Prize in 1997 in the physiology of medicines. Andrew Fire and Craig Mello. So they discovered RNA interference. They discovered RNA interference or gene silencing by using double-stranded RNA technology in the nematode. So say they first discovered in a nematode called Chenorhabditis elegans. It is a model nematode where they discovered RNA interference or gene silencing technology. So this was especially used against viral diseases. So this RNA interference is traditionally or otherwise called as post-transcriptional gene silencing, that is PTGS. Post-transcriptional gene silencing. Further, they shared a Nobel Prize in the year of 2006 for the discovery of RNA interference or gene silencing technology. So let me tell you how this gene silencing or an RNA interference works. So let us consider it is a DNA. From DNA to what will happen? Messenger RNA will be formed. So from messenger RNA, what will happen? From messenger RNA, proteins are formed. So this is original mechanism that happens in the inside every living cells. So the formation of the transmission or the conversion of DNA to mRNA is called transcription. Transcription means DNA to mRNA, that is transcription. From mRNA to protein is called translation. So what will happen by using this double-stranded RNA, it inhibits translation mechanism, which means mRNA won't be formed. So if mRNA won't be formed, what will happen? Ultimately, proteins won't be formed. It can't able to bind to the plant viral cells. So it inhibits the translation mechanism. After inhibition of translation mechanism, even though the mRNA formed, the message can't deliver to form proteins. The message can't deliver to form proteins, or it inhibits the formation of mRNA. That is, translation mechanism can be inhibited by using double-stranded RNA, that is post-transcriptional gene silencing mechanism. So the next one is Li et al., who reported the role of proteins in the present head tissue of aphid vector. So vectors plays a major role in transmission of plant viral diseases. So in the next classes, we will see how vectors are important in transmission of plant viral diseases. And they found that head tissue aphid vectors in the transmission of viral diseases, and they found that two proteins as receptors of BYDV, which means barley yellow dwarf virus. So two proteins are found in the aphid vector which are identified in the barley yellow dwarf virus. So they act as a sensors, that these two proteins act as a sensor. If absent in any aphid, no transmission will occur. So these two proteins are very, very, very important in aphid vector for the transmission of barley yellow dwarf virus. If these proteins are absent, there is no transmission can occurs. Even though if the aphid with no two no proteins of these two proteins, it can't able to transmit Barlow Ehler dwarf virus, that was reported by Li et al. And then 2002, P. Lava Kumar at ICRISAT, he made a breakthrough discovery, and he's discovered that Pygon P. sterility mosaic virus, which was transmitted by aerophid mite, he sequenced and he identified that Pygon P. sterility mosaic, which was transmitted by aerophid mite. Earlier years, he was worked in ICRISAT, that is International Crop Research Institute for Semi-Arid Tropics. So he was awarded as a Young Scientist Award by the SIGAR, Consultative Group of International Agriculture Research, which comprises of almost 15 plus 1 international, total 16 international organizations that works on agriculture, especially agriculture as well as animal development, which means production, I mean food production and productivity. So now he is working in IIT, Indian Institute, International Institute of Tropical Agriculture. Now he is a scientist at IITA, International Institute of Tropical Agriculture. He is a P. Lava Kumar. Actually, I directly talked to Lava Kumar in 2018 when we met in IPS at Tirchi, especially that banana research center was there at Tirchi. And the Tirchi in 2008, I cleared some doubts regarding next generation sequencing. He is a P. Lava Kumar. So these are all the contributions and development that happens in plant virology from past to present. So the man who studies history can make history.